Hello everyone, myself Rashmi Arora, Assistant Professor of Pharmacology, welcomes you all to the YouTube channel of Chameli Devi Institute of Pharmacy, Indore. Today, the topic of discussion will be non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. We will cover this topic in three subsequent parts. Today, we will discuss about the first part. This type of agents, they are most commonly used and easily available. We can say that they are available over the counter. When we feel body ache, when we got temperature, high temperature, we go to the chemist and take these drugs over the counter without any prescription. So these are non-prescription drugs. They can be easily available. Let us study. Non-steroidal anti-inflammatory agents commonly have three major functions. First, they are analgesic. Second, they can be used as antipyretic. And third, they are anti-inflammatory at higher doses. Analgesic means pain relievers. Those agents which relieve the pain, they are analgesic. They do their analgesic function by inhibiting the cyclooxygenase pathway from the arachidonic acid, and from antipyretic effect, they inhibit the pyrogens. This antipyretic effect is basically centrally derived. Analgesic effect is peripheral derived and antipyretic effect is centrally derived. And anti-inflammatory actions, they can be seen only at the higher doses. These are some drugs which contribute to have analgesic and antipyretic as well as anti-inflammatory effect and used in various type of disorders or ailments. Basically, they are symptoms treatment drugs. The first category is acetic acid. The drugs are diclofenac, etodolac, indomethacin, salindac, tolmentin. Then the next category comes as propionic acid derivatives. Those are fenoprofen, flubiprofen, ibuprofen, ketoprofen, naproxen, and oxaprozin. Then phenamates include meclofenamate and meclofenamic acid. Salicylates, which are most common, aspirin and diflunisal. Naphthylalcone, nabutamon, oxycam, peroxycam and meloxicam, and choline magnesium trisilicate, that is salicylate. These all agents, they are blocking the cyclooxygenase inhibitor non-selectively, because means they can block COX-1 as well as COX-2 enzymes. However, selective COX-2 inhibitors, they pose anti-inflammatory effect as well. Those are celecoxib and rofecoxib. Many of the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory agents have now been banned in India. One is Brufen and another is the tablet Nice, which contains nimesulide. We will see in our subsequent presentation why these have been banned or withdrawn from the market. Very common brand names include, which are available over the counter for the symptomatic relief of pain or high fever or inflammation signs, are Dolo 650, Disprin, Paracip and Crocin. All these are easily available and well known for everyone. The common pharmacological actions of all the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory agents are, as we have already discussed, they are analgesic, centrally and peripheral effect, may or may not involve prostaglandin related effects. Antipyretic is specifically central nervous system effect, एंटी इन्फ्लामेटरी एक्सेप्ट एसिटामिनोफेन अकर्स ड्यू टू मेनली द प्रोस्टाग्लैंडिन इनहिबिशन. सम ऑफ द एजेंट्स दे हैव बीन नोटिस्ड टू इनहिबिट द एक्टिवेशन एग्रीगेशन एडहेशन ऑफ न्यूट्रोफिल्स एंड रिलीज ऑफ लाइसोसोमल एंजाइम्स एज वेल एंड दैट इज हाउ दे कंट्रोल द एंटी इन्फ्लामेट दैट इज हाउ दे कंट्रोल द इन्फ्लामेशन इन द बॉडी. Some of the drugs they are used as uricosuric means they are used in the treatment of gout. This is the pathway which is going to be blocked by the drugs of this category. Arachidonic acid metabolites are basically harmful or they create inflammation, pain and high temperature in the body by means of releasing various pro-inflammatory mediators which are responsible for these type of symptoms. So our drugs which comes under this category have been mentioned with blue color in this flow diagram. You can easily see from arachidonic acid we get prostaglandin G2 and from G2 H2 synthesized. This H2 then has various variants then which gets converted into PGD2, E2, F2, thromboxane A2, prostacycline. These all they have various functions. For example, if we talk about prostaglandin D2, they cause a smooth muscle contraction and inhibits the platelet aggregation. Prostaglandin F2, they causes also the smooth muscle contraction along with it bronchoconstriction and leads to the abortion. Prostaglandin E2, which further has variants EP1, EP2, EP3 and EP4, leads to vasodilatation, hyperalgesia, fever, diuresis and immunomodulation. Then comes thromboxane A2. Thromboxane basically is responsible for the platelet activation and aggregation. Along with it, it causes vasoconstriction as well. And prostacycline, when gets synthesized, it leads to the vasodilatation and inhibits the platelet aggregation. So these various effects can be blocked easily by the use of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory agents, whether they are selective category or non-selective category. So in both the cases, cyclooxygenase enzyme is the major enzyme which leads to the conversion of arachidonic acid into prostaglandins. So we are going to block this pathway at the very first stage with the help of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory agents, cyclooxygenase 1 and 2 inhibitors category, so that arachidonic acid won't be able to get converted into their active metabolites and exerts their ill effects. Also, how the control of vascular tone and platelet activation by thromboxane and prostacycline takes place, we can see in the diagram. This is the blood vessel outer shell, and inner wavy cells represents the endothelial layer. Sky blue color shows the platelet formation and how thromboxane A2 when gets activated causes the platelet aggregation, and prostacycline it inhibits the platelet aggregation. When it comes into picture and thromboxane A2 gets subside, then platelet won't aggregate. Other pharmacological effects includes they all inhibit the cyclooxygenase enzyme, which results in the inhibition of prostaglandin synthesis, and that is because this inhibition of prostaglandin is basically responsible for the therapeutic effect of this category. But inhibition of prostaglandin synthase in gastric mucosa leads to gastrointestinal damage. Only prostaglandin which is responsible for the good effect is they maintain the intactness of gastric layer and thus thereby blocking the GI damage, which could result into dyspepsia or gastritis. So this is the only positive effect of prostaglandin. When what we require is to block the GI damage by maintaining the intactness of the gastric mucosa. The common adverse effects which are shared with this category are platelet dysfunction. When we block the pathway, then it may lead to platelet dysfunction. As well, when we block this pathway, prostaglandin synthesis also gets blocked, then it leads to gastritis and peptic ulceration, which is a major side effect of this category. And it may result into renal failure, sodium and water retention along with edema, analgesic nephropathy, prolongation of gestation and inhibition of labor, hypersensitivity reactions, and GI bleeding and perforation. Let us see how non-steroidal anti-inflammatory agent causes mucosal ulceration. Basically, when we put NSAIDs to block the arachidonic acid pathway, then the loss of prostacycline-induced inhibition of leukotriene B4-mediated endothelial adhesion and activation of neutrophils takes place. And non-steroidal anti-inflammatory agents are responsible for increased interaction between the leukocyte and endothelial, which results in capillary obstruction on one side and generation of oxy-free radicals on the other side. Capillary obstruction may lead to ischemic injury, and due to release of reactive oxygen species, endothelial direct injury takes place. Ultimately, both these contribute to the perforation of gastrointestinal inner tract, which leads to mucosal ulceration. This is basically all because of the loss of prostaglandin E2 and PGI2 mediated inhibition of acid secretion and cytoprotective effect, which inhibits the mucosal ulceration layer. But due to the blockage of this whole step, mucosal ulceration takes place because of the loss of prostaglandin functions. So this is all about the part 1. We will continue our specific drugs in part 2. Till then, stay with us. Thank you.